Recently, another vulnerability has come to light. L1TF, or L1 terminal fault, happens for similar reasons to the Meltdown vulnerability that affected Intel processors earlier in 2018. In Meltdown, the processor is busily reordering instructions. It tracks these in an internal structure known as the reorder buffer. When it performs a data access, it will do the permission check and tag an entry in the reorder buffer. Then, when the instructions complete or retire, it will check at the last second to see if data access was supposed to occur. If it was supposed to occur, everything's great. If it's not supposed to occur, what will happen is the processor will undo the speculatively executed instructions from the reorder buffer. Like Meltdown, the L1 terminal fault vulnerability also occurs as a result of attempts to speed up and parallelize this permission checking activity. During execution of programs, processors need to access many different parts of system memory. Applications have a view of system memory, known as virtual memory, in which the addresses that they are using for individual memory locations are actually translated using a CPU structure known as the memory management unit. The memory management unit translates virtual addresses as used by applications into the physical addresses located in system memory chips using a series of software-managed structures in memory known as page tables. Page tables form a hierarchical structure in which different parts of a virtual address are translated into a physical address by walking through the individual entries of the page table. This is performed by special hardware inside the memory management unit, known as a page table walker. During the page table walk, the processor will perform the translation, but it will also check other attributes of the page table entries. One of the attributes that it will check is whether the page table entry is valid or present. Non-present page table entries can exist for many different reasons. A classical example of this comes as a result of an abstraction called swapping, in which applications have the illusion of having much more memory than is physically present in the machine. Memory that hasn't been used recently is swapped or moved out to disk, and the underlying page table entry is marked as not present. Then, when a later access occurs to that memory location, a trap or a fault will occur, and a software fix-up routine will run that will look at this page table entry, read some bits from that entry to work out where the memory is actually located on disk, and pull it back into the processor, changing the page table entry to present, and then resuming the application. The application is not aware that the swapping activity has happened, other than perhaps a small delay to its memory access, and everything continues as before. So having not present page table entries isn't in and of itself an unusual thing, especially on a very busy and active system. In L1TF, the processor will see a page table entry that's marked as not present, but because of an aggressive performance optimization, it will take this knowledge, tag the reorder buffer to say that at some point in the near future, an exception has to be raised to the operating system. And meanwhile, it will continue to speculate forward. During this small window of speculation, it will take the address bits of this page table entry and forward it to the internal processor data cache. Then, if a suitable entry that matches the physical address from that page table entry happens to already be loaded into the data cache, it may be forwarded speculatively to further operations within the program. What this means is that a malicious attacker can cause the creation of not present page table entries pointing to physical addresses of interest. These physical addresses could point to secrets, cryptographic keys, and other sensitive information within the machine to which the attacker should not have access. There are several different variants of the L1 terminal fault attack. The first concerns bare metal operating systems. It's possible for a malicious application to use standard Linux software interfaces to cause the creation of not present page table entries and attack the host kernel on a bare metal machine. This in and of itself is of course quite bad, but we can mitigate against the bare metal attack by making some relatively straightforward changes to how Linux generates not present page table entries. We can make sure that when we generate these not present page table entries, we do so in a way that they are never vulnerable to the L1 terminal fault attack. We do this by making sure that certain bits in the not present entries are always set. This is through a very simple change to the operating system that has no measurable performance impact. The bad news is that a third variant of the L1 terminal fault vulnerability impacts virtualization. Intel processors incorporate a technology known as extended page tables, or EPT. In EPT, a guest virtual machine is able to co-manage its page tables in cooperation with the hypervisor. The guest provides one level of page tables, the hypervisor provides another, and every access to memory inside a guest virtual machine is actually translated twice, first using the guest page tables, and then using the host page tables. By having these two stages of translation, it allows a virtual machine to have the illusion that it has access to all of its own physical memory, but its physical memory is actually virtual memory within the host machine that is translated again. A malicious attacker can create specially modified guest virtual machine images in which the kernel will generate extended page table entries that contain physical addresses of interest on the host. Ordinarily, what should happen is that memory accesses through these guest extended page tables should be translated twice, first by the guest virtual machine page tables and then by the host's page tables. But in L1TF, the processor will begin to walk through the guest's page tables, notice that a page table entry is marked as not present, and tag the offending data access to generate an exception. During a small window of time prior to that exception being raised, the physical address inside that page table entry will be speculatively forwarded into the processor's data cache. The address that's forwarded, however, is an untranslated host address. So now we're only performing one level of translation, just the guest translation. These translations are fully under the ownership of the malicious virtual machine. Any physical address in that offending page table entry will be forwarded without the translation at the host and without any confinement by the hypervisor. Therefore, if there is any sensitive data at the physical address of interest in the host memory, the malicious guest is able to speculatively retrieve that using an attack similar to Meltdown. The offending data accessed by the malicious virtual machine will eventually generate a measurable fault. And we are working on means to detect and monitor this. But unfortunately, that speculation window during which the physical address of interest is forwarded means that the virtual machine has already read the data that it wants prior to us being able to trap and analyze this. As with other vulnerabilities, we can't change existing field-deployed hardware. All we can do is look for ways to mitigate against the impact of these vulnerabilities. We can't prevent L1 terminal fault attacks, but we can render them less useful by making sure that there are no secrets of interest to a malicious virtual machine as it tries to perform an L1TF attack. To do this, we perform a series of modifications to our hypervisor and kernel. First, on entry into virtual machines, we will flush the level 1 data cache of any secrets. This means that any L1 terminal fault attack won't be able to pull anything of interest out of the cache because it's been flushed. This flushing activity, of course, has a performance impact that is measurable, anything between a few percent and up to 15% overhead. But it's not a devastating performance impact, and it will serve to keep customer data safe. Secondly, we have to make some changes to how we handle a technology in Intel processors called hyperthreading. Hyperthreading is a technology that allows more efficient use of CPU resources, recognizing that today's workloads are often heavily threaded in nature. Hyperthreading introduces an additional nuance to the mitigation of L1 terminal fault. Because hyperthreads very tightly share resources with one another, it's possible that one hyperthread may be running a trusted virtual machine, while another hyperthread is simultaneously running a malicious virtual machine. Hypervisor has been modified to flush data caches whenever it begins to execute virtual machines. Unfortunately, in the case that two peer hyperthreads are running different trusted and untrusted virtual machines, it's possible for the malicious actor on the untrusted virtual machine to be trying to read from the data cache, while simultaneously the trusted virtual machine is trying to flush that same data cache. A race condition exists, and there's a small window of time during which the malicious actor may still be able to read data speculatively from that data cache. L1 terminal fault is a complex vulnerability that will affect each environment differently. In some cases, it may be necessary to disable Intel hyperthreading. In other cases, especially those running only trusted host and guest operating systems, this may not be necessary. We recommend that you consult Red Hat's use case-driven documentation and take all steps as appropriate to your local environment and security policy. To learn more about this and other vulnerabilities, as well as recommended mitigations and remediations, visit redhat.com, and thank you.